If there's one thing that we've learned during these days is that astronomers are not able to keep secrets. In fact, news of an enigmatic radio signal from the direction of Proxima Centauri, the sun's nearest stellar neighbor, is plastering the headlines. The discovery was leaked to the British newspaper The Guardian, which reported the story December 18th. Researchers subsequently granted interviews to Scientific American and National Geographic. Since then, however, the discovery team has remained tight-lipped about the signal. Have we just detected a radio communication from aliens? Well, I really wish we had. Unfortunately, there are some clues that it might be a radio signal from an artificial Earth satellite. Take a look at what we know. This will help us to take stock of the situation. The Proxima Centauri radio signal detection recalls the WOW signal detection on August 15, 1977. The Big Ear radio telescope in Delaware, Ohio, received the most powerful signal it would ever detect during its decades of observations. The signal lasted just 72 seconds, but when an astronomer spotted it on a computer printout days later, he was so impressed that he quickly scrawled, "Wow!" in red pen across the page. The data looked much like what SETI astronomers expected to see from an alien intelligence. However, despite many attempts to follow up on the find, the so-called WOW signal has never reappeared. Was that ET or was it not ET? Nobody knows. Seth Shostak said, senior astronomer at the SETI Institute. Nobody has ever found another explanation for what that might have been. It's like you hear chains rattling in your attic and you think, my God, ghosts are real. But then you never hear them again. So what do you think? However, our signal is profoundly different from the WOW signal. In fact, it lasted about 3 hours instead of 72 seconds. Also, the detection was made possible by the Parkes Radio Telescope in Australia. It was picked up around May 2019, but it wasn't noticed by the team until October this year when one of the project's interns, Shane Smith, noticed it in the data. But let's go deeper. What made this signal so intriguing? What's interesting in it? Well, we'll start saying that there's no official paper about this signal out yet because scientists involved are still working on the analysis. What happened is that someone leaked the story to the Guardian newspaper, and since then, media have been chewing this up. This is why one could think this was just a sort of trying to ride the wave, exploiting the public's curiosity to make some audience. And that's what we were thinking, too. But during these days, we have gleaned various bits of information from the astronomers' team so that we could add pieces to the puzzle, leaving the publicity topic behind. What we know is that BLC1, yes, this is the name of the signal, and everyone knows that astronomers are no good in giving names, as well as they are not good in keeping secrets, is a very narrow band signal at the frequency of 982.0 megahertz. In case you don't know, a narrow band signal is an optical signal or an electronic signal that has a spectral composition, for example, a frequency spectrum, that is limited to a narrow band. In the audio spectrum, narrowband sounds are sounds that occupy a narrow range of frequencies. In telephony, a narrow band is usually considered to cover frequencies from 300 to 3400 hertz. Now, we don't know how narrowband it is, but to have passed the various standard tests, it is likely of order of one part in 100 million or better. The interesting thing here is that as far as we are aware, there is no astrophysical radio source that can produce such narrowband radio signals. Do you know what this means? That this signal is almost certainly artificial. Also, as a standard check in order to be sure that the signal wasn't detected due to a flaw in the telescope, they moved it on and off target repeatedly. This technique is known as nodding. Now, if the signal is persistent when pointing away from the target, that tells you that it's almost certainly just a flaw in your telescope and not aliens. The breakthrough team reportedly observed this stuff for 26 hours during the campaign, spanning multiple days. And it was during one of these three-hour blocks that they detected the 982 megahertz signal that passed this nodding test. Now, this is a very interesting idea, but it doesn't definitively prove that the signal is astrophysical in nature. After all, it could still be an orbiting satellite around the Earth. But the fact that the signal persisted for 3 hours is very interesting. We know also that Proxima Centauri is a small, low-mass star located at 4.2465 light years away from the Sun, and it has two confirmed exoplanets, Proxima Centauri B and Proxima Centauri C. Proxima Centauri B orbits the star at a distance of roughly 0.05 AU, about 7.5 million kilometers, with an orbital period of approximately 11.2 Earth days. Its estimated mass is at least 1.17 times that of Earth. Proxima B is orbiting within Proxima Centauri's habitable zone, the range where temperatures are right for liquid water to exist on its surface. But because Proxima Centauri is a red dwarf and a flare star, its habitability is disputed. So one could end up thinking that the BLC1 signal may be actually an artificial signal sent by the inhabitant of Proxima B. Wishful thinking. Could this be the truth? Unfortunately, I have to tell you that 982 megahertz frequency is indeed one of the frequencies commonly used in telecommunications. A radio telescope has to deal with spurious artificial signals all the time, and that's one of the main reasons we often speak of wishing to put one on the far side of the moon, where this wouldn't be such a problem. Since 982 megahertz is a frequency used in telecommunications, we could try to explain the signal supposing that it came from a satellite in the so-called LEO orbit, which whips around the Earth once every couple of hours. In other words, they don't stay in the same position long enough to explain BLC1. So perhaps the signal is caused by a satellite in a higher orbit, one with a long slow period that would stay stationary long enough. One possibility is the so-called Molnija orbit satellite. The name Molnija derives from the name of the first Soviet satellites that were positioned on orbits of this type during the 60s. It was a constellation of three satellites capable of offering continuous coverage of the Soviet territory, similar to that which a satellite in geostationary orbit would have had, but centered on regions located at very high altitudes, not reachable otherwise. These orbits aim to observe high-altitude regions of the Earth continuously for surveillance or communication purposes. A Molnija orbit is a highly elliptical orbit with an inclination of about 60 degrees. And guess what? Proxima Centauri is located at an angle some 60 degrees below the ecliptic plane. Then, these orbits are one of the rare types of satellites that would have the right inclination to potentially pass in front of the Parkes telescope during one of these observations. Another interesting thing about our mysterious signal is that whenever an object that emits an electromagnetic signal is moving relative to us, we detect a variation in its frequency. This is due to the Doppler effect. If the object is moving away from us, the frequency diminishes, and if the object moves closer, its frequency increases. Anyway, just to give you an example, this is the sort of thing they're looking for. This plot from Howard Isaacson's paper on the topic shows the actual signal of extraterrestrial technology beaming a radio signal to the Earth. In this case, it's not aliens, it's Voyager 2. The vertical axis is time going up. Each bin is 10 seconds or so. The horizontal axis is frequency, and each bin is a few hertz. Note a few things about this signal. 1. At any given moment, almost all of the power is concentrated into a single frequency bin. This is how we know the signal must be artificial. 2. The signal's frequency is shifting towards lower frequencies as time increases, upwards. This is how we know the signal is not from Earth. The telescope is on the Earth, which is rotating. As this happens, the telescope is first moving towards the source as the source rises, then moving away as the source sets. Meanwhile, we just have to wait and keep dreaming. On the SETI Institute website, we can read, "Yes, as long as we still don't know, we should continue to consider the alien hypothesis viable. After all, any SETI detection is going to be dicey when we first make it. There will be plenty of calls for restraint intended to pacify the all too eager, but it's reasonable to expect that someday one of those suspicious signals will, indeed, be the sought after proof of intelligence on another world. Caution is often a good idea, but one must be careful not to toss the baby with the bathwater. After all, this baby could change our concept of the cosmos. We would like to end this video recalling the famous story of the Fermi paradox. The story goes that in 1950, Enrico Fermi and his colleagues were discussing the existence of alien life over lunch. The question that Fermi asked the table became infamous in its simplicity. "Where is everybody?" The room fell silent because, well, nobody had an answer. In fact, the Milky Way is about 10 billion years old and 100,000 light years across. If aliens had spaceships that could travel at 1% of the speed of light, the galaxy could have already been colonized 1,000 times. Why haven't we heard from any other life?